What I wanted to talk about today is about the organic formation of communities. And we have been at Wildfire, has been working on and studying the just the natural processes of how do communities form up. If you take a place that has a sense of belonging, how do people come together? How do they organize themselves? And how do they make something happen? So over the course of 13 years, we've been working in 7 different communities to learn from them about how they get organized, how do they make something happen, and what are some of the really common elements between all 7 communities. And so what I'll be sharing with you today is some of the findings that we've come to as we have undertaken this study. First, let me share a story about an African village. This is a case study that's been written up about this village in Africa that received funding for the development of a water system in their living quarters. It was a village that had no one running water in each of their homes. And so through the support of an international funder, a series of engineers came into the community and they began to do surveys and looking for, you know, the sources of water, and then began to develop the system of giving access of water to every one of the members of the community. Interestingly, after the system had been developed, the community became increasingly concerned about this water system. So when some of the officials from the funding institutions came and inquired about it, what they learned was is that the community said, you know, we have now more conflict now than we had before. That we are not, ever since this water system has been installed into our homes and our living quarters, we're not getting along as well together. Huh. We're not getting along together. What relationship do we have between water and this and getting along together? And they said, well, it's because in the morning, our women would come and we would go to the river to bring water, but also to wash our clothes. But while we were there, we began to work out our differences. We began to mediate some of the issues that were percolating within the community. And once the water system was established in the community, we no longer had a reason to go to the river. And so our women never had no longer the social space to begin to address and resolve these differences. So these are examples of unintended consequences in development. And we began to see at Wildflowers the importance of beginning to understand the community from the community's point of view, to be able to see the power there's no doubt that had the funders appreciated and seen this very informal but very powerful social structure work in creating a social fabric of the community, there would be no doubt that they would have worked out a different system. But it's the absence of that understanding that led them to say, you know, this was really an unintended consequences of a very well-intended effort towards development. Given that we are now positioning ourselves globally as well as in communities of color in the United States and abroad, really the question is, do we have the tools, do we have the knowledge, do we have the capacity to reach into the community, to be in relationship to the community, and to understand the community in a way the community understands themselves so that we see their strengths, and so that they see their strengths? Because sometimes the communities say, well, you know, that's just the way we do things around here. And they don't necessarily name or claim those strengths, but nevertheless they're very powerful and they are the silent, hidden voice and hidden beam of light in the community. So we were challenged by the question 13 years ago of how do you then begin to enter into community and understand their strengths? How do you see their power from their point of view? How do you see how they organize, how they think about their community? If we take away the fire station, we take away the libraries, the health centers, the youth programs, and we just say, let's not think about yet institutions as deeply and as very important as they are. But let's just say, how do you just kind of get organized? That's the question we ask. But we needed a process that not only revealed some information, really not more than information, revealed to us a framework for how the community sees themselves and how they're organized. But we also need a process that the communities can then respond to right away and say, oh, I get this. Oh yeah, actually this is very cool because I never saw it this way. I'm learning something from this experience in such a way that they want to come back. Because our concern was, this is a learning process for us and a journey for us. And how often will communities actually be open to and avail themselves to us as we began this process of learning about communities. So over the 13 years, we've been working, as I mentioned, in 7 communities, and we've developed a process. It's an unusual process, but it's actually a process that we got patent for this technology. It's a breakthrough technology. And what I'm going to show next is an example of this, of our process. It's a story of Bird who he calls himself Bird. It's Curtis Mays is his formal name. He lives in South Central LA, and we were interested in, as we were working in Los Angeles, an understanding among the many, many different voices of the community. We were interested in hearing and seeing the social reality that young people face. What is their reality? How are they seeing it? What's going on with them? What are the challenges? How are they? Now, you'll hear Bird and his story. It's actually a really remarkable story, a very powerful story, and Mary's a very challenging story. But there's a lot of hope in the story, and you'll see from this, I hope, an example of a video clip where he talks about his community.
It's Curtis Mays, also known as Bird. This right here, it's my interpretation of the jungles. This is what I go through every day. All right, this is me right here. This is how I start my day off right here. All right, this right here is the homies. This is the homies right here. And this right here is our so-called enemy. These will be the Bloods, and these will be the Crips right here. But see, what we don't see in the middle, it's greed, envy, jealousy. Right here in the middle, as you can see, he's smiling. As you can see, he's smiling because he knows that the outcome of this war is nothing but this right here. All right. So as I keep going on with my day, I walk past the school and I see a teacher, a professor, if you will. He's teaching the kids. But see, what they don't see is secretly, he's teaching the kids the art of war. Right here. Okay. I keep bailing on with my dad. Right here. This is Superman. This is the big time dope dealer right here. As you can see, all the kids in the jungles, they got their eye on him. Because he got the big rocks. He got the cores. He even got the trees in front of his house. But see, what they don't see is my man right here, supposedly a dope head, he's an undercover cop. He's about to end off all his little grind, and the kids ain't gonna have nothing to look up to no more, because he gonna be behind bars, so he's out of the picture. Okay, and this right here is your common 18th streeter right here. He in the cut, nobody don't see him, he's lurking. He done already killed 2 of the homies. But the doctors and the policemen, they don't see nothing. They backs is turned. They don't see none of this. Because they came too late. This right here, this is what? Arnold Schwarzenegger. Arnold Schwarzenegger. or as you can see, the jungles is not all good, but it's good enough for us, you know, to live. He wants to tear everything down because he don't see nothing but dollar signs. But see, what he fails to understand is this is where we have to live. But he don't care because all he sees is dollar signs. So he gonna tear all this down and we left with nothing. Nothing. We ain't got nothing. No more nothing. Just because we failed to understand what this man right here is trying to do. We so involved in everything else. Oh, cars. Oh, I got big rocks. I'm gonna sell rocks. Oh, I got this. I got that. But we not realizing the big picture. They moving in on us, and it's gonna happen eventually. Eventually, everything is gonna come to a halt. This is the park right here. This is a basketball player. He's an aspiring basketball player. Skills, best person in the hood. But what he don't see is his friends right here, snakes. They always gonna pull him down.
And yet it's a deeply embedded reality, not only in parts of California, but other parts of the country and other parts of the world. Now, and our challenge is at Wildflowers was to say, well, this is just one voice. We can't take this much further than to understand that as important as this one voice is, it's just a shared voice. And so we began to meet with other gang members and gang leaders, and we had them also construct models of their community. Now, what's powerful about these models is, as you can see, I mean, it's in a way you're looking, well, these are toys, you know, people, blocks, what's going on? But really what they're doing is, and what we found is so powerful, is that you can tell your story this way. You can tell your story. If you're just verbalizing it without three-dimensional objects, without them, you have to speak in a much more linear fashion. But in the process of using three-dimensional tools, it really opens up an amazing volumes of information and understanding and a framework, right? The way Bird located the school, located the drug dealer in the middle of his model, and where the elders were at the periphery now. I mean, this just gives you such clarity on how he is seeing his community. And again, our work is to make sure that it's just not an individual perspective, but actually is a shared perspective. So we have groups of people begin to build models. So our second approach is to uncover the social realities of different groups of people. We have business people doing it. We have spiritual leaders building models. We have cultural leaders building models. We have community-based organizations, nonprofit organizations build models. And through that process, what we begin to see is all these differences. But we see something in common. We'll see a pattern that exists in communities, and the communities, even more importantly, see these patterns. And this is where they find themselves continuing wanting to come back and do model building from time. I mean, it's not every. I mean, we do model building with the community maybe 3 or 4 times a year, but this has been for 10 or 15 years, and they do this because they get to a point in their development, in their building, when they say, you know, something's not happening. As hard as we try, it's not working. We need to get another lens on this. We need to begin to get a deeper insight into what's happening. And that's when we get involved in helping them. Okay, another approach that we take to understanding communities is to discover the power of individuals to hold the community together. We're particularly interested in identifying the weavers of the social fabric of the community. Given the all of the challenges that we all face in the economy, that where we have to move where the jobs are, or we have to drive 2 hours to our place of work, the whole sense of coming apart and fragmentation exists in our lives. And we think at Wildflowers that this is a particularly important time for us to begin to think about and identify the weavers, the people who are forming the community, holding the community together. They're doing it 24/7, and they're doing it not because they're getting paid to do it, but because it comes from their heart and their minds, and it's because this is their home. This is perhaps where their ancestors lived and are buried, and this is where they feel the deepest sense of belonging. So what I'm going to show next is a series of 2 to 3 digital images, photographs, of how we have come to identify these social weavers. We call them, we'll call them informal leaders of the community. What you see here is a photograph of a group of tribal people from the highlands of Laos. They call themselves the Lao Yumien. 30,000 came to the America in the 1980s after the Vietnam War. The leaders of the clan had collaborated with the CIA during the 60s and the 70s, and President Reagan instituted an executive order to evacuate and to house all of these of this community of people in America in the 80s. 5,000 came to San Francisco Bay Area. And so what you see here is a group of spiritual leaders. Every year they go to hold a ceremony. They're Taoists by religion. They go to this park that has redwood trees, and it's a half-day ceremony where they pray to their ancestors in this park. And what I wanted to draw your attention to in particular is this fellow right here with the glasses on. All right. His name is Cao Chem Chow, and this photograph was taken about 3 years ago. We've known about Cao Chem Chow for about 15 years, close to it. And we've heard him talk, we've seen him in action, and every time we've seen him and heard him talk, we don't see his power. We just could not get a sense of. We heard the community talk to us and say, let's talk to Cao Chem about this, or we want to make sure Cao Chem's at this meeting. But we never saw his power. I mean, when he's at the meeting, he'd say a little bit, and then that's it. And then we'd say, okay, we had a video camera on him. We'd say, come on, Mr. Chow, tell us about, what do you think about the Yumian community? And so we just couldn't get to experience his power. So then we decided, it may not be in this context in which we can appreciate the power of Mr. Chow. So a year from this photograph, there was a documentary that Wildflowers collaborated with the several leaders of this community. They were the directors of this documentary that spoke about their journey in America for the last 25 years. And what we decided to do was to take, when we attended this meeting at the community center where they showed this documentary, Mr. Chow, we were sure it was going to be there. So before the meeting, we went outside, and there is Mr. Chow, right, standing in front of a tree. And we heard that Mr. Chow, where he hangs out always by this tree. So just before the meeting, I went out and I just took a photograph thinking, well, if he's there, it'd be really great to catch a shot of him. But what's also interesting is, and there he was, yep, he's there, and there's a tree. I mean, his father was chief of the Orange Tree Village back in Laos, so there is some association, although this is not an orange tree. But what's also interesting is that every one of these individuals are also informal leaders of the community, right? They weren't just, they were the residents, and they're important people just by virtue of them being a resident then of the community, but they also held in a higher level of standing among other members of the community by virtue of their leadership role in the community. So every one of these were standing around Mr. Chow talking in advance of this meeting. So then I thought, okay, we showed the video, we heard a group of spiritual leaders comment about the video. It was really a positive, it was a wonderful session. Then I thought, well, after this meeting, is Mr. Chow going to go back to the tree? And if he's going to go back to the tree, is anyone going to be there? All right. So let's see. Sure enough, here he is again, right? And with a different group of informal leaders of the community. So suddenly we begin to see his power. Suddenly we see that his power is to influence other informal leaders, not necessarily outsiders, like folks at Wildflowers. And why that is important, because then we can think strategically about ways that we can, as we work with this community, we can see where Mr. Chow can be most helpful in building understanding, building consensus, and working out differences. So the third approach we use is to identify significant individuals in the community and to really look for and understand the power that they have, because power is such an invisible force, and yet it's always present. But it's present among people and activities. If you take the activities of people, it's gone. It's only powerful among people and activities. So our sense is we have to see this power in context. In context, okay? So our fourth approach in helping communities and in seeing the formation of and how they're organized is to begin to have them articulate how they work together to function together and how their relationships are in that process of doing something together and what the culture of that community is. I'm going to show the next slide, which is of Ningbo, China, where you'll see a group of migrant workers who are working in a steel factory. And this group of migrant workers have been living in a city called Ningbo, 2 hours south of Shanghai. And they have formed into a community, about 5,000 of them. And they come from a province called Anhui Province. And those of you who have been to China and been to Anhui Province know that Anhui is a really tough province because it's built in such a way that's very little agricultural land. Right, so most of the people who live in Anhui have to go to other provinces as migrant workers. They're household workers or they're construction workers, but it's really a tough life. So this group of migrant workers had migrated to Ningbo to work in the steel factory. We were fortunate enough to be able to get, this is actually a pretty amazing opportunity because generally China won't let any international organization by virtue of just how thoughtful they are and also careful they are about internationals being introduced to the local communities. But they trusted and respected us, and so they said, sure, we'll invite you in and help us understand our community. So what you're going to see next is a group of informal leaders from Ningbo who are migrant workers, they live in Ningbo, but they're from Anhui province, who've resided there for 10 years, and they talk about their community and how it's organized, okay? You'll hear the interpreter behind the Chinese, and the session is being held at one of their community centers.
This is the Anhui Street. Most of the people live here are from other provinces. 6 to 7 households out of 10 are from other provinces that came to work here. And this is the security patrol, all volunteers. And in the middle, we have an activity room, and the old and the young can both go there to play. And we have green zones on both sides, and we have streetlights. Here's the activity room. This is for old residents and new residents. We can read newspaper, play mahjong, play Chinese chess, sing and dance, read magazines. We can do everything there. Everyone can go there, the working people, the old and the young. Everybody can go there. Actually, the street is not very big. But in our hearts, it's very big. We can take a look this afternoon. We should take a look. We feel really proud of this street. We make it really clean, and we have pictures of the residents on the wall. The TV station came a number of times, and they called it the Anhui Street. And so we people from Anhui have to protect it well. What I think, what they said are important too. But this is a lifelong memory. When I go back to my village in Anhui, I hope when I go back, I can tell my grandparents and parents and my children, when I was in Ningbo, when I was there, there was a street there, and I can tell them how it was like. It would be a lifelong memory. The security patrol starts working at night after dinner. Is it safe here? You can't say that because we have security patrol that it's not safe here. Even Tiananmen Square needs security patrol. We want to have the security patrol so that we can be responsible for our own security. This is the scenery outside the classroom. Here's the teacher who's giving a lesson. He really cares about our new residents. This is the classroom of love. Every community has such a classroom of loving heart, so that the children of the new residents can be taught, can go to school. The teacher is volunteering, and he's a really good teacher. This is teacher Cheng from Anhui. We teach all kinds of classes on our hygienic issues, there are classes on other issues, and the community really cares about us. The classroom of loving heart is for children in the summer, in their summer recess.
So as we learn from this work, and by the way, this was the first time we met with this community, and so the openness and the amount of information that we garnered from this model building session was pretty amazing. We saw that there is a formation. They have a leadership formation. We saw the leaders speak, but we also saw that in the models. We saw that there was a security system with people in some hierarchy. We saw that there were a community center. There was also a recreation center. We saw that the bridge was a place, a social space, informal space, where the new and old residents came. And there was tension there, and then they hinted at it. But there's always tension when new and old residents come together, wherever it is, whether it's China or America, wherever. And so how their strategy, how they organized in order to address this new and old tension, was to begin to both identify social spaces, have community centers in which new and old residents would be invited to, as well as to be sure that there's a security system in place so that there is general safety for children and for the elders. This for us was actually a pretty important part of our learning, because for the first time we saw just groups of people showing their own initiative to make their lives and their communities so much better. And you heard how proud they were of Anhui Street. And you see that young man who had his mustache and he was sinking, and he was really, he really wanted to express this notion of memory, going back to speak to his grandmother, speak to his parents, and speak to his kids, how proud he was to be involved in the building of this community. Okay, so I'm gonna go now to, I know I'm apologize for the technical hitch, but I'm going to just summarize a bit of some of the findings that we have come to at Wildflowers, and then to talk about some issues that we think face funders and local government as they begin to work in communities, work with the organic formation of communities. So the first finding that we came to is that there is, in fact, an informal leadership of the community of people who are the weavers of the community. They are relationship-oriented. They build the community. They're working towards conflict resolutions. But it's done in a personal and social way, a very natural way. It's a 24/7 kind of involvement, and again, they're not paid to do that. And there are six characteristics in which we've identified that are common between all seven communities. And by the way, the seven communities that we're working in is African American East Palo Alto, work in an indigenous Indian community in Albuquerque, New Mexico. We work in Frank's Landing, which is yet another Indian community in Northwest. It's not the Lummi Nation, but it's to the Olympia, Washington. The Filipino community south of Market, the Chinese community, the Lao Yumian community, and I think that's it. If I might have forgotten one, I'll let you know after the presentation. But among these communities, we identified six characteristics. One is that they have a long track record of dealing successfully with all kinds of pressing problems. Right? They've been in the community, they're embedded in the community, they're there 24/7, helping out, just making things happen. Secondly, the other people in the community recognize them for the good deeds that they do. Yeah, there's Mrs. Mouton, there's Mrs. Wilkes. Yeah, Mrs. Wilkes has always been there with us. Or Mrs. Ogman, she takes care of our street. Right? The third is that they're invisible to outsiders. As soon as an outsider comes in, it's just, you know, from an outsider point of view, you just don't know they're there. I mean, it's not that you don't really try to identify everyone, but it's just they kind of, they're not front center stage. They're somewhat behind the scenes, but they may be bringing the tables in or the chairs in. Or I remember I met Mr. Hocknett, who's from the Cambodian community in Stockton. First time I met him, he was carrying a table across the room. You know, and I was thinking, oh, that's Mr. Hocknett, you know. And so I got up and tried to help him, you know, carry the table across. But it's people who are just everyday wonderful people who are just making something happen. And they're generally not identified as being leaders. The fourth, of course, is that they're very modest. And they don't seek media attention, nor political positions, although they carry a lot of power. In that, by virtue of their standing in the community, the respect that people have in the community, when they are involved, other members of the community will follow. Fifth is that their role and authority is created by the community without external mandate. Right? Institutionally, they're not authorized to do this. They are doing it because, you know, they'll say, come on, Mrs. Mouton, you go ahead and do this. Mrs. Mouton said, no, I can't do that. Yeah, go ahead, Mrs. Mouton. Yeah, you're the one. Right? Oh, okay. You know. And then lastly, they're motivated to help others, not for monetary gains. They're not paid to do this. They generally have jobs that are reasonably low-paying jobs, but they make enough to take care of the families, take care of their grandchildren, and like Mrs. Ogman, I think she has one of her sons is an NBA basketball player in Los Angeles. It's just really an incredible story. But these are your informal leaders, and these are their characteristics. We thought about, in one of the sessions, we mentioned Bob G is one of your informal leaders. I mean, I don't want to embarrass you, Bob, but just, you know, the kind of wonderful elder that Bob is, right? He's kind, he's connected, he's doing it because of his heart, because of his commitment, right? I mean, this is the fabric, right? This is the fabric of our communities. This is what holds us all together. So our first finding is that there are informal leaders. Our second is that the community, holds activities that have unrelated generative effects. So you have an event, but something really positive happens at an event that you don't anticipate, right? But you leave the event and say, wow, that was really a great event. Yeah, I didn't expect that would be so cool. You know, it's these kinds of activities that we think actually build communities. And more people come to these events. The first time we came to this finding was in Chichicatepec, which is in Oaxaca, Mexico. This is 4 hours south of Oaxaca. And this, the Chichicatepec community is composed of 5,000 Mije indigenous people who live on the mountainsides outside of the city. And we were interested in engaging with them in a development effort. And they had not been, had had much experience with international organizations. So we went there and spent 4 days with them living in their families, learning about their community. And on the third day after we'd established a rapport, we said to them, you know, we're coming here and we know we're going to, you know, cause a little bit of rumble. I mean, just, you know, we're going to introduce new ideas and, you know, we'll probably introduce a little bit of funding, and both of which is going to, you know, cause a little tension. How do you deal with your tension? You know, how do you resolve your conflicts? And so the leader said, it was just like right, just right off the top, they said, oh, it's the fiestas. So we kind of blinked our eyes and said, fiestas? They said, yeah, fiestas. And they said, you know, as leaders, what we do is we plan, when we have a fiesta, we plan to do our social healing at that time. You know, when we go to fiestas, we meet up with the people that we have hurt, and then we ask for forgiveness, right? And yet another leader said, he says, so I have to get this exactly right. The fiestas prevent an angry relationship from turning into a dysfunction between the heart and the stomach, right? And so what this community has created on their own over time, and this community has actually been around for hundreds of years, is the capacity to be able to heal themselves and bring themselves together. And they figured out that it's every major event is not just an event, but something else generative has to happen. So our finding is that as we saw that, and we saw the evidence for that, we then began to go back into our other communities. I don't think we have time to show Dallas Press. I'm really sorry about the lack of time, but I apologize. But Dallas is yet another one of our wonderfully informal leaders in East Palo Alto. He's a barber, and he, the kids love him. Everyone knows Dallas. Dallas cuts the best hair in East Palo Alto. And so the kids go to Dallas, and Dallas counsels them, right? Dallas is giving them a direction and giving them advice when, you know, sometimes these kids don't either want to talk to their parents or don't have someone significant to really talk to at that time. And so I would have liked to show you this video where Dallas talks about, you know, the way that he provides and provides guidance and direction for young people. And he does that in a really loving and caring way. I mean, Dallas is probably in his 70s now, and everyone knows Dallas. But there are many Dallases around in all our different communities. And these are just two examples of many, many different individuals and leaders who intentionally think about how to make an event generative. Right, how do I have a reception but have something else happen in that reception? And how to make that happen in such a way that it comes together. Right? Our third finding is that there are social spaces in the community. And by this I mean that these are geographical locations in which groups of people identify with and have a certain meaning to this space. This room actually would probably be, I haven't been here long enough, but my guess is that this room actually is a certain kind of social space for the school and for the center. That something happens here that everyone knows this is a certain kind of not only events, but has a certain meaning to you. And so as we began to look at our communities, the seven communities, what we found was that every one of the communities had their own social spaces. Youth would have, there's a video clip that you'll see on our website, that where the young people are talking about their social space in South of Market. And if you ask the Filipino elders their space, it'd be a different social space. But what's really important is for us to begin to map all these different social spaces using our model building process. And then we begin to see the whole community. And when we can see the whole community, our role then is to serve to think about how do we strengthen the fabric? And how do we help to gain insight into some of the expectations and assumptions that holds the whole community together? There are reasons why everyone comes together, and there, oftentimes they'll say, because I like this, I like that, and there's this kind of event going on, but there's something else underneath it. There's a sensibility, there's a set of assumptions. Our work at Wildflowers is to begin to uncover these assumptions and then hold these assumptions up like mirrors to the community so that the community, you know, the community will know. They'll say, oh gosh, that's right. You know, and when they see it and they can name it, then it strengthens them. And so our strategy for social development and of community development is to see this fabric, understand these premises, and strengthen it so that the community can really be stronger and build and organize the kinds of amazing service programs that, you know, that they do and they need to do more of, okay? Charlotte, thank you very much. I'm really honored to have this chance to share what Little Wings.
Questions from the audience? Okay, sure.
First off, thank you very much for presenting today. We really appreciate it. And I guess the question I had is, as you were talking, a question that kept rolling through my mind was, you know, everything you were saying sounds fantastic and sounds very, very legitimate for the establishment of a community. I guess the question I had, though, is what you see as the main reasons, or there may be a million reasons, of why this can't be more sustained in more places and more communities. Is it functions of size? Is it functions of ego? Is it functions of money? Is it all of the above? I mean, I think of, you know, like the nation of Bhutan, which is, you know, famous for having the happiness. Gross national happiness as a metric for their establishment, for their nation.
Yeah.
And then that's great for Bhutan, and it works in Bhutan, but can that work elsewhere? I mean, just thinking of these other areas of community and why it doesn't work.
Right.
It sounds great.
Yeah, that's really, thank you. Very thoughtful question. We don't know how big, but once it gets too big, it actually loses its integrity. And though we don't know what the number is yet, that's something that's on our radar. What we do know is that there needs to be a balance between the formal and the informal sector. When there is too much of the formal sector, it loses the heart and spirit. If it's too big of the informal, there's a lot of heart and spirit, but there's actually not a very good engine for economic and business development. So the real challenge is having some kind of way of balancing the informal and the formal. I know this is an abstract answer, but it's how we're beginning to, you know, narrow in on this. We'll see some communities that are very old and have lots of institutions, but they're fighting each other, right? And no one wants to come to the table. No one wants, oh yeah, if he's gone, I ain't going to this meeting, you know, that kind of stuff. So and when that happens, what we see is that there is not the culture of the community. And I think the culture is organic. I mean, I think it comes from people having certain values, loving each other, and making something happen. That's what I think culture is. Right, and when that isn't present, then actually the fabric begins to break up. Yeah. Half answer, working on it, but thank you. Yeah.
Another question for Dr. Liu?
Yeah.
Yes, Kim?
Hi, we kind of met yesterday, and so many of the students have had the opportunity to learn a lot already. What keeps bugging me, though, is I mean, it's amazing the fact that you are in a funding position and you're actually looking for informal leaders, because based on my experience before coming to the school, funders usually really look for formal institutions. And I mean, it's so radical. And yet when you explain it, it sounds so logical to use this method. And I guess, how do you see this becoming more of a movement and less of the exception?
I think it's happening. I think that informal leaders, and they are fundamentally interested and engaged and want to be more engaged in schools. The challenge has always been that they oftentimes don't feel that they have the space to be as powerful, and not in that, that kind of power, but their concern and the way of thinking and their sensibility oftentimes gets diminished in an academic or school environment, in particular, like a public school environment, when it's operated by different rules. So I think what has to happen is, and I hear it happening in the funding world, slowly, really slowly, but I hear it happening is a funder saying, the informal leaders is, I mean, they can pull the numbers in. If you want to have a meeting with 300 people, Don Luis is going to be able to do that. But not the PTA. Right? And so there are challenges to working with the informal leaders because their power resides in a sensibility, in an environment that is really love and giving, and it's not a set of structures and rules and processes and bylaws and charter. It's none of that. And so we really have to, I think it's among all of us here, we have to begin to build this interface. We have to begin to build this understanding and to be really appreciative of the terms and what terms do we engage in such a way that we can honor the Don Luises and the Mrs. Moutons, in our formal spaces, as well as them being welcoming us and honoring us in their informal spaces. It'll take time, but I'm sure it's going to happen. I'm sure of it.
I think we have time for one more question. The audience? David?
I'm curious about the with formal structures, you have a transition of power that is kind of built into the system.
Yeah.
What about for informal leaders? How does power move, and how do you make sure that there's always an informal leader?
Yeah, the Lao Jimien community, we've seen that their power is really the members of the community anoint the leaders to be power or to hold a certain position, and in the district they are organized by districts, and I used to think the districts were like San Francisco, Oakland. Well, no, districts are the village back in Laos, right? So District 1 is Aleutian Highlands, and District 2 is 80 miles away in another part of Laos. But they hold on to this memory, and when they come to America, they still organize in their village structures, and then they elect every 2 years their leaders, which is amazing innovation. I had the assumption that, here are a traditional, very, very strong cultural community that may hold on to and be resistant to change. That's not what I've seen in this community, which is actually the women have built the temple of the community. And yet, if you were to ask, where's the women in the leadership structure, there is none. But it's really clear from speaking to the leaders and seeing how the women have built this temple, they raised three times, they raised almost $1 million from a community that probably doesn't, their average income, family income, is probably no more than $40,000 a year. Amazing, amazing. So, but it's the members of the community is anointing them when it works. But there are certain ingredients. It has to have some sense of fabric, and these leaders have to be there to want to do. And it usually gets quieted down when there's a lot of conflict, and there is not the appreciation that they can actually do something. So they'll just kind of stay on the sidelines until things cool out a little bit.
Yeah. All right. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr.
Thank you very much. Yeah, thank you.